Hey, Free Play Frank. Well, tonight's going to be the first installment of my music lesson series. I'm going to make a video every month or so about music. So tonight I'm going to be discussing with you guys how to deal with emotion in songs when you're singing romantic songs and so on. And then just to show you that it works, I'm going to play an 80s classic that you ladies are just going to love. I Can Dream About You by Dan Hartman. All right, let's get going. All right, so tonight I want to have a discussion with you folks about dealing with emotion when you're performing music. Now, this video is mostly aimed at singers and musicians, especially male singers and musicians. And what I'm talking about here is various emotions that you're going to experience as you attempt to perform a song, and what generally is going on there is songs are extremely powerful memory triggers. So say you were a child in the 70s and you're in a 70s cover band and someone suggests singing a song that was on the radio the week that your grandmother passed away, or the week that the girl that you had a huge crush on at school told you that she didn't like you. And what's going to happen is, as soon as you hear that song, like when you turn a song on to try to start learning to play it, you're going to start experiencing those emotions that you experienced when you first heard that song. And I'm not exactly sure why that happens. Smells are another very powerful memory trigger as well. Music and smells are two of the most powerful memory triggers. So supposedly you had your heart broke because you lost your grandmother, or you lost this girl that you were in love with, and you were a child, so children generally don't process emotions very well, especially male children. And so what's going to happen is you're going to start probably experiencing the same emotion in the same type of intensity that you experienced when you were that child during that period, losing your grandmother or whatever. And it's not going to be, you're going to have a heck of a time trying to learn to play the song and sing the song. You know, hopefully you're practicing by yourself. You're not just going to wing it at rehearsal. You know, because if you do, you're going to start to, you know, the other guys at rehearsal, or they might give you a hard time. You know, they're going to say, hey, are you crying, dude? You know, stuff like that. And it's going to be embarrassing for you, and you're not going to really know why this is happening. Well, I'm going to do my best here to explain to you guys why that's happening and what to do about it. Because, you know, I was a child in the 70s, and I had a experience some traumatic events during that period of my life. So as you guys can see, I perform a lot of songs from the 70s because that's my favorite era of music. And there are a few that I've done that they trigger memories from stuff that happened in my childhood. And I had a heck of a time learning that song to play for you guys. And some of those songs I learned 30 years ago, and you know, I played them back then, and I can't remember whether I was having trouble with the emotional aspects of it that long ago. But usually this stuff doesn't usually happen when you're young. It usually catches up with you years later. Like if you're in your 20s and you're still remembering something that happened to you when you were 10 years old, that's not really all that long ago. So the amount of time that memory's been in your brain isn't going to have that deep of an effect on you. Whereas if it's 30 years later or 40 years later, and it's something that you haven't thought about since, or maybe you can't even quite remember, like it could be, maybe you were a victim of abuse when you were young, and that song was being played in the background on the radio or whatever while the abuse was going on, and somehow your brain blocks those type of events out, because that's how your brain protects you. It's going to block those events out so that you don't, you're not reliving it constantly. But when you hear that song, it's going to trigger those memories again, and you're going to get sad. Or maybe it's something that made you really angry. Like maybe you got bullied at school or something during the period when that song was very popular. Or maybe you were on a vacation with your family and you had a bad accident, and one of your family members didn't make it. And that car was on the radio while you were on that trip. Like, just imagine that. And now, 30 years later, you're in a 70s cover band, and someone says, hey, let's do House of the Rising Sun. And you're like, yeah, okay, sure. And then you start to learn it, and you're like, why am I getting so upset? I can't stop myself from crying every time I hear this song. I can't even get through the first chorus. I'm bawling my eyes out. Well, most likely that's why. So, and usually this, for some reason, like, this happens to guys, male musicians and singers, quite often. But very rarely happens to female singers and musicians, because women live on emotions and feelings. And, you know, they've totally got this shit down. Like, they can deal with the emotions. They have their ways. And, I mean, she might start crying, you know, but 10 minutes later, she's going to be smiling and laughing again, because women are just so good at dealing with emotion, whereas men generally aren't. You know, I had to teach myself all this stuff. Like, I learned this stuff by reading psychology books and stuff when I was young, and, you know, all that. And, you know, and even though I'm very well aware of the processes that are going on that causes this to happen, you just still have that period when you first start trying to learn this song that's triggering those emotions. So what you need to do, guys, is you need to just keep playing that song and keep forcing yourself to get through the song. And as you do, and as your brain is learning the song, you're learning to play this song, and you're getting better and better at playing this song, your brain is going to replace those old memories with new memories. So by the time you get the song worked up to speed till you're ready to take it to your rehearsal or a gig, you should be good to go. You should be able to play the song all the way through without breaking down. That's generally how it works with me. Like, when I was younger, I can't remember having this problem. I used to sing quite a few, love songs and, you know, romantic, slow kind of songs and stuff when I was young in bands. And most of the bands I played in as I got older had female singers, so all I had to do was play my instrument, and the vocal part was a no-brainer for me, right? So I wasn't concerned. But when you're the singer and you have to learn the song, you've got to write out the lyrics and memorize the lyrics, you're going to be going through this. And you need to just keep working on the song, just keep playing it and getting better at it, and your brain will make new memories. It will work, guys. Like, it worked for me. Like, you know, I've done this I don't know how many times. And then there's a few other issues here too that I've noticed over the years of playing music with guys. Is you get a lot of guys that they don't want anything to do with a song that's romantic or has a lot of feeling, or, you know, slow songs and that kind of stuff. All they want to play is like hard, fast, you know, heavy metal or, you know, those types of things. And, you know, with the real gruff vocals, or vocals about like grabbing a woman and taking her to bed and, you know, those type of things. And if you ever get into a band like that and you're like, well, let's do this slow song, you know, the guys are just going to like squirm and, you know, try and get out of it, or they might laugh at you for suggesting a song. And most likely this is why, you know, because most people didn't have that great of a childhood, especially like if we're musicians. A lot of musicians are kind of introvert type people that didn't do too well socially when they were young and stuff. So a lot of musicians, they discovered music as an escape from their regular life. Like, it was, became the only thing that they really identified with, like really, really good musicians. There's quite a few like that. I've watched a lot of biographies on all of these older bands that I like and some that I don't like. But that's a common theme. So no doubt, if you're one of these guys, you maybe had an abusive childhood, or your dad was an alcoholic or something like that, and you took refuge in music, like you got your guitar and you're in your bedroom with the headphones on playing, or your dad was yelling at your mom, so you just turn the amp up a little bit louder so you can't hear it, and you're rocking out to your favorite tunes, and you know, it was your refuge. So maybe 20, 30 years later, now you're in an 80s cover band and somebody comes along and wants to do like a Laura Branigan song, you know, and you're gonna just go like, you know, squirm and do everything you can possibly do to get out of trying to play that song, because you know that the emotional aspect of that is going to make you have a breakdown and you're going to be embarrassed because the guys are going to be like, are you crying, dude? And you know, you don't want that, right? So this is the solution for it, guys. Just work on the song on your own and work through that and until you get past that and make new memories, until you can do the song all the way through, and then take it to rehearsal. Yeah, it works. Like, that's really the only thing you can do. And like the ladies, like I say, the ladies can process the emotions, and a lot of women, female singers, they thrive on the emotional aspects of the song. Like, they can really identify with that, and it really brings out their true talent. And you know, that's why it's so good. I have such a great time working with female singers and musicians, because you know, I just like get off on seeing them having such a great time, you know, expressing themselves. Whereas if I'm in a band with guys and they're all uptight and they're scared to express themselves or scared to try anything new, you know, those types of things, I usually don't stay in those types of bands. Because it's just not it doesn't fill my need for my desire to perform music is to make a connection with the song and then transfer that connection over to the audience. You know, like that's what it's all about. Like, you know, I learned that from playing with female musicians, as they know all that stuff and they're all too happy to explain it all if you're willing to listen to it. So another thing that it's important to do is, like I said earlier, you might not remember why it is that you're getting upset. And you should really try hard to remember, like, what was going on in your life when that song was new. Like, what's triggering these memories? And, you know, try and then work through that. And then, like, it might just be something like a girl dumped you and, you know, a month later you were hanging out with another girl and you forgot about her, you know. And it just it seems so silly, you know, to be all upset about something that happened to you when you were 13 or, you know, like that. So then you can just kind of let it go, you know, and just go, oh, so that's what it is that keeps bothering me all the time. Oh, I get it now. And then you can just move on. Like, you know, that happened to me lots. A lot of girls told me where to go when I was in school. You know, I really, it was upsetting back then, of course. But, you know, 2 months later, I was with another girl. Or even 2 weeks later, I was, you know, chatting with another girl that liked me and forgot all about the other one that was not nice to me. And, you know, I mean, it's a lot harder, like if you had an alcoholic parents or you lost your brother or your grandmother or something, that's the memory that you're remembering. I know that's a lot harder. But as you learn the song, your brain will make new memories and then it won't be triggering that anymore. You'll just get past that. There's another thing that I discovered about probably 10 years ago, like when I was in my 40s, I'm 56 now. And what happens with a lot of people when we're in that age and we start hearing these songs that you listened to when you were a kid or teenager, and you remember all those great times, how much fun everything was, how much energy you had, and how much simpler life was, all that sort of stuff. Now you're 40 or 50 years old, and the part about it that's going to be upsetting you is the fact that you're mourning your youth. Like, you're sad that you're not that, you're old now. Like, you feel old, but, you know, your brain still thinks the same as when you were 16 or whatever. So basically you're mourning your youth, you know. Nothing bad happened to you during that period, really bad. So that happened to me. I went through that in my 40s. I'd be learning certain songs that were playing when I was having a great time in my teens, and I would go through that, you know. And that's what it was. That's all it was. There was no tragedy going on in my life at that point, or, you know, a little bit of trouble here and there, but nothing beyond what a normal 16-year-old or whatever boy would experience. So that's all it was. So just be aware of that, guys. And don't be afraid to try these, like, slow songs, romantic songs, because the ladies love it. Like, you know, you can play Megadeth all you want in your bedroom, but you play that at a gig, you're not going to get all that great of a response. But you pull out, like, a nice slow song, you know, an 80s classic or something, you know. The ladies are just going to love it, and they're just going to have a ton of fun dancing to that stuff, you know. So try it, guys. You know, like, trust me, it'll work. Just give it a try. All right, good luck.
I can dream about you.
Thanks, folks, for joining me tonight, and we'll see you all next time. Good night. Take care.